security of QKD is great, but some experimental imperfections leave loopholes for eavesdropping. So this is a picture of the very first QKD implementation. There's like a LED here. Alice sets her state here with some electronics. There's the 20-centimeter quantum channel. And then Bob performs his analysis and detection over here. But it turns out that Alice's electronics here made a different noise. It made a different kind of click depending on whether they sent in the HP or the plus minus basis. So this led the inventor to say this. So that's an example of a side channel where the Alice's and Bob systems leak some information to an eavesdropper that they can use to gain information. All right, so let's start with the photon number splitting attack. This is a really bad attack, actually, that can be formed on these laser sources. So if you remember the laser, it's always a superposition of zero photons, one photons, and two and more photons. So there's always some chance that you can have more than one photon coming out. And since they all go through the same polarizer, they're all polarized the same way. They all have the same quantum state. So what Eve can do, well, she has much better technology than we have. She's only limited by quantum mechanics, so she can basically build anything. So she can actually count the number of photons in each pulse without disturbing it. So that's OK. Quantum mechanics allows you to count photons without disrupting the quantum state. So then she says, she can also store photons. So she can just keep a photon around and measure it later at some point. And she can also transmit photons without loss. That's just the way so Alice and Bob don't detect it. So right, Eve is really great, essentially. So here's the attack. So Alice sends some laser pulse out, and it has a low average photon number. But there's still always some chance to get at least two. So Eve counts the photons in the pulse. Eve essentially just blocks the channel, takes them all into her lab, and then she measures the number. She counts the photons. If there's only one photon, Eve just blocks it. She can't get any information, so she stops the pulse right there. And Alice and Bob just think it's loss. They don't worry. Then if there's more than one photon, Eve splits one of them off, keeps it in her little storage device, and sends the rest on to Bob. So Bob can get these photons, measure them. He doesn't think anything's wrong. That looks normal to him as well. So then Alice and Bob, as you know, they have to exchange basis information in the end. They have to compare their bases so they can only keep the ones where they measured in the same basis. So Eve just follows along with this. She gets the information as well. And then she can measure her stored photons, each of them in the correct basis. So as long as the loss introduced by Eve is less than the loss they expected, Alice and Bob don't notice. The question is, if they're mostly single photons, Eve's just going to block them all. So if you use a really, really low average photon number, so they're mostly zero, but a couple ones, and then very few twos, that would work. But then Bob is mostly getting nothing. So you need to have some trade-off between using a high enough photon number to get lots of keys across, but a low enough photon number so that Eve can't attack all the pulses. So the question is, why does Eve block it if she doesn't measure it? She can't get any information from these one photon pulses. Because Bob is expecting to receive one photon, and there's only one photon originally, Eve cannot measure it without disturbing it. So that's like the typical QKD that we all know. So if it's a single photon, Eve, it's better for her to block it so that Alice and Bob don't get a key bit across without her knowing anything. Yep?
Predictor, this is what I'm thinking. If Alice and Bob each have a set of data, they're going to end up matching them up to find out what the error is. But if Bob is missing one, then everything basically gets shifted up once, and almost none of it's going to match unless
right.
They realize that there's one missing. So it's essentially destroying the entire code in that formula.
There's lots of missing photons, it turns out, because most of our photons are lost just from normal absorption anyways. So instead of doing a list in order, they do it by time. So they say, at 1 o'clock and 30 seconds and 29 nanoseconds, I got this photon. And Bob says, oh, I didn't get anything there. OK, let's look at the next time. So they don't just have an ordered list. They have a timed list. So they compare their times. So they only get to use the ones that Bob actually receives. OK, so the attack is clear. Eve gains full information. Alice and Bob don't notice. So looks like QKD is broken. OK, so there's a really nice invention called the decoy state protocol. So instead of just sending the same average photon number, the same strength of pulse, Alice now sends both signal pulses, they're called, and decoy pulses. So the decoy pulses are meant to catch Eve doing this attack. So Eve still blocks the pulses with only one photon. And that means she's going to preferentially block the pulses that are slightly smaller, because they're more likely not to have two photons. So Eve's going to preferentially block these decoy pulses, preferentially allow these signal pulses. And of course, it's all probabilistic. But once the statistics are done, then you can see that more of these are blocked than these. So essentially, Alice and Bob just have to compare how many pulses arrive for these decoy ones versus these signal ones. And if they see, oh, they're not the same at all, there must be someone blocking the single photon pulses. So now they know that the attack's occurring. Yes?
But isn't it still difficult to send levels of different?
So that's actually not difficult. There's something called an amplitude modulator. And so this can really, really fast change the height of your pulse. So that's actually easy in the lab.
Wouldn't these small pulses be less likely to make it across in the ears?
Yeah, it's a good point. So they're automatically less likely to make it across, but you still have some expected number to make it across.
Right.
So if your expected amount's different, then you can detect the eavesdropper.
Can't Eve know that expected amount and just block them?
Eve can know the expected amount, but she doesn't know whether one that she measures is a signal or a decoy. She only knows the actual counted number of photons she found. So she doesn't know whether it's a small pulse or a big pulse. She can just count and say, this pulse has two photons. But she doesn't know the size of it beforehand. So that's what allows Alice and Bob to have this secrecy. So the decoy state protocol, it allows us to detect Eve doing this photon number splitting attack. And so we use lasers, which is great because they're really fast and really easy to use. Okay, so in practice, we don't actually say, oh, there's an eavesdropper, we better stop. We compute a secure key rate. This is mathy, lots of security proofs. But in the end, all you want is this R to be greater than 0. As long as the R is greater than 0, you know you have enough information beyond the eavesdropper to say, I can generate some secure key. So essentially, what goes into it? Well, there's the basis factor. We have to throw away half of our results because the basis is going to be wrong. Then there's the pulse rate, so how fast you're actually shooting your laser. And then this is the raw key, so how many clicks Bob actually gets. Then minus the information that's leaked to Eve from error correction, and minus the information that they have to do for privacy amplification. So yeah, so that in practice is how we actually compute whether we can generate a secure key. So on to quantum hacking. So this is a group in Norway, and they're really, well, there's a few other groups, but this one is the big one. They're really active in quantum hacking. They want to break QKD and show that it's secure with some modification. So what they want to do is attack the current implementations and then improve it to the next level of security, essentially. So their main kind of attack is called the detector control attack. So this allows Eve to control all of Bob's detectors without anyone knowing. And I'll just go through how this attack works. So instead of the Bob module I showed earlier, where he has this wave plate to rotate the incoming light, let's look at a passive Bob module. So this means there's the PBSs, and they measure, this one measures in the HV basis, so it can decide between the 0 or 1 in this basis. And then sometimes the photons go over here and then get rotated, and then this measures in the 45 degrees basis. So the photon at this beam splitter essentially chooses which basis is going to be measured in randomly. So it's not Bob choosing, the photon chooses randomly, but that's sufficient because he can tell which basis it was, and he can tell which number it was. So that part's okay. And the attack works because the detectors that we all use, these silicon photodiodes that I was talking about, they can be blinded with really bright light. So it kind of goes like this. This is our input light power. So we turn up the brightness, more and more photons coming in, and then the number of output clicks that the detector is saying goes up. That makes sense. More light, more clicks. But eventually, the detector starts to get saturated. So you put in more light, but no more clicks come. And then if you put even more light on, it starts to drop off. And so if you put on so much light that this detector, it essentially really can't handle it. The current's too high, and so the voltage drops, and so there's no more signal pulses coming out. So then there's no clicks. So if you put on enough light, eventually you can blind the detector completely, and it'll never click. The detector's still running. It looks like it's still working to Bob, but it just doesn't click because it's been blinded by Eve. Okay, so this is like one photon. This is maybe like a million photons, something about here. And this would be something in the billions to trillions photons. So it's like more, but it's nowhere near. Yes, it's basically logarithmic. But it's not beyond our capability at all. We can make laser pulses that have that many photons easy. Okay, so the blinded detector never clicks, as I said, except you can apply an even stronger pulse and then make it click again. So what it's called is it's called the linear mode. Instead of clicking for single photons, the detector outputs a voltage proportional to how much power is on. So we can, so we keep it above the blinding threshold. We're putting in enough optical power above the blinding threshold so it never clicks. But then we put in even more. We add another pulse on top. And so the output signal stays below some threshold. But then if we add the extra power, it goes above the click threshold of the detector. So the detector says, OK, I think I've seen a photon. I'm going to put an output pulse. So the optical power is high enough to blind it. But then if we add even more, it pushes the output signal higher and creates a click. But this is totally artificial. So we think it's detecting single photons. But actually, it's detecting really bright light plus even more as a click. So you can start to see how Eve is able to control Bob's detectors, I think. OK, so what does Eve do in this attack? Well, we have Alice and Bob here. And of course, Eve's going to go somewhere in the middle. So what she does is makes an evil version of Bob. So she copies Bob exactly and does the same measurements he does. So eventually, she'll get a click somewhere. Let's say she gets a click here. She gets an H click. Then she'll use an evil version of Alice to prepare the same state she got. So if she gets an H click here, she'll prepare an H. But she's not preparing a single photon this time. She has to prepare that really bright photon state to control Bob's detectors. So Eve's idea is to make Bob's detectors click exactly as her detectors clicked. So if Eve and Bob always have the same detections, when Bob reveals his bases to Alice and they communicate, Eve can just follow along. Eve can just follow along on error correction, and Eve can just follow along on privacy amplification. So it's because Bob and Eve have exactly the same detections that Eve can just follow along and gain full information on the key. So, yeah, so say evil Bob gets a click in H. So how does Eve make only Bob's H detector click? She sends a pulse of light, and it says bright light now. This isn't single photons. And she has to send it at a very specific power level. So first it hits the beam splitter. So it gets split up half and half, because the beam splitter is 50-50 in this Bob module. So half of it will go to one basis, and half of it will go to the other basis. So now on the wrong basis, we have this half height pulse. Then it gets split up again. But because it's in the wrong basis, half of it goes to the plus 45 degrees, half of it goes to the minus 45 degrees. And now it's always below the click threshold, even though it's a strong pulse. Yes? So in the correct basis, again, we have a half height of the original. None of it goes to V because it's in the right basis. And all of it goes to H. So now it's above the click threshold. And so you can see that of all these detectors, only this one clicks. So you can see that Eve, by knowing something about how Bob's detectors work, can control them exactly and gain full information on the key. So in principle, limited only by physics, what Eve can do is usually Alice and Bob are going through optical fiber. And light travels about two-thirds the speed in optical fiber. So what Eve can do, Eve will have her evil Bob right outside Alice, so she'll get a result. And then she'll send the result through free space, so it's traveling faster than the fiber light, over to an evil Alice right outside Bob, and then go right in. So she can catch up to where it's supposed to be, even though electronics are slow. So Alice and evil Bob don't necessarily agree. They only agree 50% of the time, like normal. But evil Alice makes regular Bob click exactly as she clicked here. So now evil Bob and Bob always agree on the basis. So then Alice and Bob reconcile their bases. So then evil Bobs are also reconciled with Alice. So the nicest way around quantum hacking, sure, we can always patch it. We can always check for this power meter, or we can add something else to always patch these attacks. The nicest way is something called device-independent QKD. So instead of just the BBM92 protocol, it's kind of a new use for entanglement. And it's really under development. There's no even, it hasn't even been built yet. But essentially, so Alice and Bob have black boxes. They don't know what's inside. They don't even care if their detectors are working, or if they even have detectors or whatever. So all they do is Alice puts in a value here, Bob puts in a value here, and they get a value out. It's kind of like a Bell test. So you put in your measurement choice, and then out pops some value. So as long as these values that Alice and Bob get out can be used to violate a Bell inequality, then they can generate a secure key. But the key is that they have to do a loophole-free Bell inequality. So one of the main loopholes is, it's called the detector loophole. Enough photons, sorry, you can't lose very many photons at all between the source and Alice or Bob. So to make it a loophole-free detection, you have to have 80% efficiency. And if our photon detectors are only about 60% efficient, well, we've lost already. We can't even hope to do this. So there's some good progress in more efficient detectors and other kind of tricks to get the entanglement across. So we'll see if this ever turns out. Yeah, it's not clear if this will work. So just to finish off this part, there's flaws in QKD implementations that allow eavesdropping. Even though security proof is good, there's some experimental implementation flaws, and any can get in there. So we can either patch holes as they appear. QKD is really going through a lot of hacking and patching right now. Or we can modify the protocols, invent new ones. For example, that device-independent entanglement-based one.